Yeah, good morning, good afternoon to you all. Now, already what we have started previous classes, that is regarding reciprocating compressors. Now, the reciprocating compressors, we have discussed the basics, everything. Now, last class, what exactly we discussed, we just have a recap. Now, just see what exactly I have discussed in the last class. Now, we have found out the expressions for work done by the compressor with and without clearance volume. Now we have done expression based on the work done by the compressor without clearance volume. Then last this is also we have completed, that is what are the expression for work done whenever the process of compression is polytropic, adiabatic and isothermal. Then we have gone to the other part, that is whenever the work done if I take by compressor considering clearance volume, Now we have seen how it happens, because without clearance volume, if you consider the suction process, the thing start from the axis itself. Now, if I consider clearance volume, you have seen that process, both suction, compression, delivery and expansion. Both compression and expansion will be like following either polytropic or adiabatic or isothermal. So the expressions for the same we already discussed in the last class, and also we have discussed regarding volumetric efficiency. What is exactly volumetric efficiency? What is meant by free air delivered? So free air delivered is one whenever you just go for two-stage compression. Okay, so if you are whatever the amount of air if you just compressing and you are expanding that particular thing to the atmospheric condition, that air which is you are delivering to the this air which you are handling is called as free air delivered. Okay, now clearance ratio we have seen, it can be actually denoted by K or C, and we have seen our expression for volumetric efficiency and clearance ratio. Then after completing all the single stage compression process, we have gone for multi-stage compression process. Now I have already explained what is the difference between the single stage and multi-stage. So single stage and multi-stage. So single stage compression, suppose I assume that 1 to 10 bar will be happened in only one stage. So that requires a very big size of a compressor, and obviously there are a lot of balancing problems, vibration problems, etc. So we have discussed already the disadvantages with single stage compression. Now the same compression 1 to 10 I can carry out in two stages, that is two stages. That particular compression process is called as multi-stage compression, and we have discussed what is known as a multi-stage compression process with intercooler, with perfect intercooling and with imperfect intercooling, with perfect intercooling as well as with imperfect intercooling. Okay, so those are the things what we discussed last class. Now we'll just go for the remaining thing, and we'll solve some more problems in this particular class. Now just if you're able to now just to see this particular just 1 minute, you just go for this particular screen here. So I hope you are able to see this. Now this is how it goes, what is the multi-stage compression process. Now I just take it something here. Now see him, you just go for this particular process here. So this is called as a single stage compression process, and this is the thing what I am showing next one. It's a two-stage compressor. Now if you take a suction there is, this is a low pressure compressor, then there is don't be like a medium pressure. Now here you may be having an intercooler, then it goes to the high pressure, then finally it goes to the delivery. So this is called as two stage or multi stage compression process. So already we have discussed what are the advantages of multi stage process. Okay, right. So now just see some problems. Okay, now just quickly I'll rush through. What and all we have discussed. Now this is exactly what we discussed in the classes. So this is for single stage compression polytropic process. Then you have clearance volume. What is the clearance volume? With clearance volume, what will happen? So this already we have discussed in the last class. We have discussed in last class this one, and you have work done. I hope you have all this for PPT with you. Now this is the volumetric efficiency. We are considering the clearance volume here. Then what is clearance ratio? Ratio of clearance volume to the swept volume. Then similar thing we have discussed volumetric efficiency, all these parameters. Then we have gone for the multi-stage compression. So don't worry about the actual diagram. Now you see what is free air delivered. The free air delivered, as I said, that it is the process where PT, VT by TT, which are the atmospheric conditions, and V1 minus V4 is effective swept volume whenever if I consider the clearance volume. Okay, so these are the free air delivered, and this already we discussed what is multi-stage, why multi-stage required. Then we have seen the expression how multi-stage. Obviously low pressure cylinder, high pressure intermediate cylinder, most of the times intermediate cylinder won't be there. So low pressure cylinder is connected to the high pressure cylinder with the help of intercooler, or if you anything like intermediate pressure cylinder is there. So you have one intercooler here and one intercooler will be here. Okay, so what is the advantage of multi-stage process? Already you have seen that there is a saving in work for the compression process. There is a saving in work for the compression process, and we have seen the expressions for multi-stage, how it happens. Yeah, so perfect intercooling for imperfect intercooling. So perfect intercooling means 1 to 4, 4 to 2, but 2 will be almost equal to 1 if you restore, then it's called as perfect intercooling. Without intercooling, without perfect intercooling means you are not going to take the 2 point or 2 condition to the 1 condition. So that's called a thing. And how I can find out the optimum pressure ratio, if you just remember, so P2 is the second intermediate pressure. So low pressure, high pressure, you have 3 pressures here. P1 intake, P2 is the intermediate, and P3 is the delivery. How to find out P2 for optimum working is, P2 is nothing but square root of P3 into P1. That's the condition for that condition, the multi-stage is adopted. Then what happens? I can find out the minimum work to be supplied to the compressor. Okay, so the same thing we discussed last class, right? So minimum work, now remember this expression here. So P2 is square root of P1 into P3. So those are the things what we discussed. Now straight away I'll just go for a simple problem you can understand easily. Yeah, now you just see this particular problem. I'll just go through fast. A two stage compressor. So how many number of stages are there? There are two stages. Now the single acting air compressor, obviously only one acting, no double acting compressor, compresses air to 20 bar. So what is the final pressure? 20 bar. The air enters the low pressure cylinder. So obviously multi-stage means there are two cylinders. One is low pressure, another is high pressure. So the air enters at low pressure cylinder at 1 bar and 27 degrees centigrade and leaves at 4.7 bar. Leaves at 4.7 bar, right? So the air enters the HP cylinder at 4.5 bar and 27 degrees centigrade. The size of LP cylinder is 400 mm. Diameter they have given, and the clearance volume he has mentioned that it is 4% of respective swept volume or stroke volume. The compressor runs at 200 rpm, and he is asking to take the compression and expansion process both as 1.3. That means he is considering the clearance volume. With clearance volume he is asking to find out, finally he is asking to find out estimate the power required to run the compressor, that is what is work done by LP cylinder as well as work done by HP. Then finally, what is the heat rejected in intercooler per minute? So you are adopting an intercooler. How much heat is rejected after low pressure compression before it goes to the high pressure compression? Okay, so just go through the problem. It's very easy. Just go through this particular problem. You can easily understand. Now see P4, because you have P1, P2, P3, P4. So the final pressure is two stages they are here mentioning. So 1, 2, 3. So final pressure is 20. Now P1 is the initial pressure, temperature T1, and P3 is 4.5 bar, and temperature is so and so, and all these parameters you can note it down. Now, first of all, we'll just see how the PV diagram goes. Yeah, the note PV diagram. Yeah, just I'll explain. So two-stage compressor, right? So first, I'll try to find out what is swept volume of low pressure, because we have given the dimensions for both low pressure as well as high pressure. First, find out what is VS1, swept volume of. So you know what is D1, what is L1, 5/4 D square L1. You use the, what is the swept volume of low pressure cylinder. Now we know this particular formula, that is in terms of clearance ratio, what is volumetric efficiency? That is 1 plus K minus K into P2 by P1 whole to power of 1 by N, where K is clearance ratio. K is clearance ratio. We already explained that clearance ratio is ratio of clearance volume to the swept volume. Now this is given in the problem as 4%. So what is the volumetric efficiency now? 1 plus 4 by 100, 0.04 minus 0.04. Oh, then because after LP cylinder, the pressure is 4.7 bar. So what is the pressure ratio? 4.7 by 1 whole to power of 1 by n is 1.3. So you will be getting a initial what is swept volume of low pressure cylinder like this, or sorry, volumetric efficiency like this. So how much is volumetric efficiency? You got around 90.85%. Now using volumetric efficiency, what is volumetric efficiency? It is volume of air which is going to admit, that is V1 by VS1. So volumetric efficiency is given by how much volume you are taking inside by swept volume of the compressor. So that if it keep it, then what will happen? I can find out what is V1, that is how much is swept volume, 0.06284 into volumetric efficiency, into volumetric efficiency. So it's around 0.0571 meter cube per stroke. Suppose I want what is the meter cube per minute, just multiply with the help of compressor speed, you just multiply it. So you'll get finally what is the value of a volume in terms of meter cube per minute. So this is meter cube per stroke into strokes per minute is how much, or revolutions per minute is how much, given as 200. So that gives the meter cube per minute. So volume is 1.42 meter cube per minute. Now similar way, if I found out the for LP, I'll find out what is the volume taken for the HP compressor. Again, it's given by this particular. How I can find out this? Suppose I know what is P1, V1, T1 form thing. I know if what is P2, V2, T2 or P3, V3, T3. Now I just equate P1, V1 equal to P3, V3. Okay. Now this particular thing gives you how much is the volume sucked into the HP compressor. That is 2.54 meter cube per minute. 2.54 meter cube per minute. Right. Now, once you got the both the volumes, now what is work done? That is first LP stage. It is P1, V1, N by N minus 1. This formula already I explained in the slides. So you got the work done by LP compressor as 2,123 kilojoules per minute. Okay, so this is the value. Now, once you know what is the LP, what about HP? Same thing. Instead of P1, V1, you can go for the high pressure cylinder intake is at P3, V3. That is high pressure cylinder is P3, V3 into P4 by P3. So P4 is the final stage. Okay, then you have power of N minus 1 by N minus 1. Now you just see here the same values, whatever available in the problem, I have substituted. Now I have found out what is work by LP compressor as well as work by HP compressor. Okay, so this 10 cubed indicates I have taken everything in the kilopascals. So P is kilopascals. Here it's a joules per minute, means this is like a bar or pascals. Okay, so corresponding unit, just make it And finally, you make the both HP as well as low pressure work done in kilojoules per minute. That is 2123 kilojoules per minute and 2034 kilojoules per minute. Now, what is now total work done for us now? It is combination of work done by LP cylinder, work done by HP cylinder. Now, this is the total work done. That is 4157.8 kilojoules per minute. Now, what is the total indicated power? So, this is work done. Now, if you just by 60, if you keep the power. So, what is the total power required to run a compressor or work required for the compressor is around 69.3 kilowatts. That is the multi-stage compressor problem. Okay. Now, this also I have sent to you. Now, just refer this particular website. Just I have given the one link. You press that link, you have very good information for the compressors. Okay. So, just we'll go for some more problems. Maybe one more or two I'll take. Now, this C. Now, just see this particular problem. Yeah. Now see the problem, you can easily understand. A reciprocating compressor single stage double acting type delivers 20 meter cube per minute, measures the free air condition is 1 bar 27. The compressor has compression ratio of 7 and condition at the end of suction is 0.9735. Compressor runs at clearance volume is 5% of set volume. L by D ratio is given. Determine the volumetric efficiency and dimensions of the cylinder and isothermal efficiency, taking index of compression and expansion as 1.25. So hope you understood here the different data given. So compressor is single stage double acting, so we have to consider it's a double acting type and it delivers so much air. Now what I'll do first, P1 I know and the ratio P2 by P1. Okay, so only single stage only, so there is no nothing like a multi stage, right? Now this is problem gives you the idea of the how to find out the work done considering clearance volume in detail. So V3 here they have mentioned as, so V3 is the clearance volume. Just see the diagram below. So just go for the diagram below. So V3 is the clearance volume here. So V3 is in terms of VS is given as 0.05 VS. Now VS is how much? V1 minus V3. So what is VS now? V1 minus V3 if you take, it becomes your VS. So I'll get V3 in terms of VS. How much? 1.05 VS. Now this you remember. Here there are two conditions. One is free air condition, another is suction condition. So free air condition is like a PT, VT by T I have given. So that PT is 1 bar and temperature T is 27 degrees Kelvin. So now how much mass of free air delivered is? Using this gas equation, I'll find out how much is given is 23.23 kg per minute. Now what happens? Just see. So for compression process, we know that this is the process, compression, 2-3 delivery, expansion, again suction. So like that it goes. So 1 to 2 will gives you, if you take PU to power of 1.25 is constant, what is T2 I can find out. And from 3 to 4, I can find out what is V4. So V4 is given as in terms of VS, 0.05 VS. So V4 also is given as in terms of V4 is equals to V3 into this particular ratio. Once you keep that, V4 equal to 0.273 VS. Now V1 minus V4 I need because that is the effective sweat volume what I required for the work done formula. So that is given as 0.813 VS. Now volume of air corresponding to suction conditions. So this I have to take into account because the air which is taken is at the finally expand to the free air condition. Now for that I'll take the pressure corresponding to the free air delivered condition, temperature. So P1 V1 by T1 equal to PT VT by TT. If you just take this particular formula, so I can find out what is amount of air I am taking. That is a free air delivered volume I can find out using that formula. Now, what is volumetric efficiency now? Actual volume is how much you're taking. The delivered is how much? It's around 0.7868 VS. How much the, what is the volumetric efficiency? Actual free air taken to the cylinder by swept volume. Now this is your volumetric efficiency, that is 76.8%. Okay. Now to find out the dimensions of cylinder, so this is the procedure I explained here. Just go through that. The volume of the air, how much sucked per cycle is 20 by 2 into 240. That is so much meter cube per cycle. Okay. So these values are given. Now volume of cycle equal to swept volume. That's the actual volume which you actually taken. So which is given by pi by 4 d square L. Now D I can find out like this, L I can find out like this. Now what is the work required by the compressor? Either it's a P1 into V1 minus P4 into P2 minus T1, or you go for this particular N by N minus 1, M or T2 minus T1. Anything is okay. So we'll get around work as 109.18. HP means once you divide by 0.7457. So 1 HP is 0.7457 kilowatts. So it's called as work done. Okay. Now I know what is the work required for the actual work is so and so 109. That's the actual work. Now what is isothermal efficiency he is asking. So what is isothermal work? It's given by P1 V1 ln P2 by P1 or ln R. So that formula already we discussed for isothermal process. So once you keep this formula, particular parameters here, you will find out what is the isothermal work done. Now what is isothermal efficiency? Ratio of isothermal work by actual work. So what is the actual work? 109.18. Isothermal work is 89.31. So once you just keep these particular parameters here, so finally you will arrive at the isothermal efficiency as 81.33%. Okay. Now you have plenty of problems. I have sent one textbook also for you. So just go through those problems. Then if you have any clarification, so once I complete this, I'll open the group thing. You just message me. So just I can reply for you. Okay. So these are the different models available as part of a compressor, single stage as well as multi-stage compression process. Okay. So just go through the problems. If anything not able to understand, so just get back to me. I'll solve it for you. Okay. Now we'll go for a very important topic. Next topic is that is rotary compressors. Right. Now will be very interesting. Just I'll just close this. Okay, just now just to go through this. This is called as intercooling, already what we discussed. The efficiency of compressors already you have discussed. Now this is what I mean, the next topic, that is rotary air compressors. Now what are the compressor what we discussed above, that is the reciprocating compressor, that is very high pressure application. Okay. Now you have the other classification which shows that it is rotary compressor, that is very small pressure applications I can use the rotary air compressor. You can easily understand how it works, and as the name indicates, there won't be any reciprocating thing. You have rotors. The rotors may be in the form of lobes, screws, vanes, or volumes. So there are four types of rotary compressors available. So small, if you take your cars and all, like your small pumps, you have this particular air which is need very small pressure rise, then I can go for these particular small compressor. So screw compressor, vane compressor, lobe compressor, centrifugal compressor. Okay. Now just axial flow. So there are five types of compressor. Now just go through the screw compressor. So this is how it looks like. This is how it looks like. I'll make you clear. Don't worry. Right. Now see. So what is screw compressor here? Now you see here there are two things available which will be like a screws. Now incoming air will be taken like this, and the screws, one is driven, another is a driver. So suction air will be going like this, and that air which is entrapped between the space or clearance between the two driver as well as driven screws, it gets compressed and actually comes out with a small pressure rise. So this is same thing I have shown. Now just observe this time being, how it looks like. Yeah, so I hope you are able to see the screen. Yes, yeah. Yeah, just go through the video here. Now you see here, this is how your screw compressor looks like. So just 1 minute. Yeah, this is how it looks like. So just go through that particular video what I given, and this is the two screw things available. Now you just see here, yeah, these are the two screws. So one is driven, another is a driver, another is a driven. Okay, now what happens, you'll be taking air from suction here. I'm showing by highlighting here. So this is a suction. So you see the blue color, that's the air which is taken, and the compressed one is coming as a red color, which is coming at the bottom. Okay, just go through once. Okay, so one, yeah. So just able to understand what exactly happening. So this is the very small pressure application, and this is how the thing looks like. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Just see. Yeah, that's how it goes. Now suction, compression, delivery. So very small thing, and because of the space here, it get compressed, and the air which is taking. It gets compressed here, and compressed air will be coming out of this. So this is called as the screw compressor. Okay, right. Now so we'll just go back again. Yeah, this is how the screw compressor works. Now similarly, you have one more arrangement. So instead of screw, you have something called as a vane compressor. So it how it looks, it's very simple. They'll be asking how it's going to be work. So this is how the vane compressor work. Now you see here, just I'll take a highlighter so you can understand easily. You can just keep it in one words and you can draw this. So air is taken like this, and that air is going to a particular arrangement. You see this white color one. Okay, and the thing which is having a small hatchet like portion here, that is connected to this. This is called as disc here, which is actually eccentrically mounted. Now this actually, whatever the air it goes here, because of this eccentric movement which is connected to the vanes, so the air which is entrapped in this space will be gets compressed, and that compressed air will be just taken out and comes out like that. Okay, so just you're not able to understand, just see a small video. You can easily understand how this particular air compressor based on thing works. Yeah, just go through this. Yes, now this is how a vane compressor work. You see here, this is the thing which is offline thing. and you see there is a space between these two. So air which is coming here, blue color, will be entrapped in between the spaces, in between the spaces. So this is the thing. See here. So this air is coming here, and this is the slots. These are the slots. These are the slots. So once it moves, so these are the vanes fixed here. Now this particular thing is going on moving. So the air which is coming here gets compressed because of the this particular movement here. Now you see here, once it moves, yes. Now air is going like this. It just gets compressed. So once it gets compressed, it just comes out of this, yeah, as a compressed air thing. So this is how your vane compressor work. Now just see. So these are called as vanes. Yes. Right. So similarly, this is one sort of a arrangement where how it works they have shown. Okay. Now we'll just go back once again. Now this is how the vane compressor works. And what are the other two important types of compressors? We'll just discuss and we'll finish it off. Now this is the lobe type compressor. Now you just see there are like two kidney beans. Now this is the how the arrangement is there. Now the air is entering here like this. This is suction because of this particular small clearance. Once it starts rotating, because one I'll be giving a movement that's called as a driver. So this starts rotating. Now because of this movement, one movement will create the suction. Now that air which is coming here will be entrapped in between the space here. Then that gets compressed and that will be taken off and sent to the delivery. So there are two lobes instead of two screws which works and compresses the air. Okay, so that's the how the lobe compressor works. Okay, now we'll go for the other one, that is how the screw centrifugal compressor. Now if you might have understood about the centrifugal pump, it's having the same arrangement. That is, you would be taking the air and you have a arrangement called as impeller. So impeller has rotor. So whatever air is taken here, so that air is going to compress because of the movement of the rotor or impeller inside. So the air which is coming inside will be compressed because you are rotating the impeller, and that impeller exerts pressure on the air, and that air is going to deliver out. So this is happens by means of a centrifugal action. You see here the pump. If you know what is the working of a centrifugal pump, the same thing will be shown here, because here instead of a pump which is having water, now it's replaced by air. Okay, so these are the different types of compressor. And what is the final one is axial flow compressor. Will be looking like this. Just I'll finish it up because we're running out of time. Okay, now any doubts you have, just so if you have axial compressor, it will be like this. Most of the gas turbines uses the gas this particular axial compressor. You have stator as well as rotor. So stator have blades, rotor will be keep on rotating. So the air coming here will be entrapped between the stator and rotor and gets compressed and it will be delivered out. So axial flow compressors are used most of the times in case of your gas